you doing, Randy?
Doing great. How are you doing?
I am excellent. Good job on the jacket.
You know, this is all my wife.
If
I was left to dress myself, I would be wearing like misfitting game t-shirts that I got from conventions, yeah. Shorts, sandals. It would be a mess.
Yeah.
My wife dresses me.
Yeah. Mike Drucker pulls me together before the show.
So
it all works out.
Right on.
Exciting times for you. Borderlands 2.
Yes,
coming up right here.
It's very exciting.
Yeah, September 18th, right around the corner. Before we get into that, what were you thinking with this Duke Nukem Forever?
What do you mean?
Like, it was one of those things, we haven't talked about it, and like, you Duke Nukem wasn't going to happen forever, and then you guys came in and you saved it and you put it out.
Yes.
Why did you want to do that? It was Duke Nukem. It was like, eh.
Yeah, but it's not, it's the Duke. Let me tell you, I'm much happier living in a world where Duke is alive and not dead.
Okay. I can live with that. I mean, that's fine. Like, I try to save a whole bunch of failing things too.
And if if we had to be the ones to resuscitate him and make sure he could live to save us from the aliens.
Aliens one more time?
Yeah.
Is that something you'd want to keep going? I mean, you guys came in late on that project. It wasn't like Gearbox was
developing it. When 3D Realms went away, it was really, it was in 2009 when the word came down that they had shut their doors and that everyone had been laid off. And that was like a sad day. You know, I moved to Texas back in 95 or 6 to join the Duke Nukem 3D team. And that Duke Nukem 3D was like the first commercial product I was ever involved in.
Yeah.
So my friends were over there working on the game. They've been working on it for a dozen years. That was a sad day, man.
Sure.
This is a bummer. So, I think we at the studio, we kind of felt like, there was like a dying patient and we just happened to be the doctor in the house. So, like, you're not just going to let the patient die, you know? And the thing is, when I went in there and I looked at it, it's like, it's a beautiful patient.
His dying patient's beautiful.
No, Duke is one of a kind. There's no character like him in the industry, and he's larger than life. And I looked at I played the content that they had made, and I had a lot of fun with it. And there was things that I did in that game that I've never done in a video game before, and wild experiences and crazy puzzles that could only be possible using that unique set of weapons and some of the jokes. And, it's like a machine gun. It's kind of like a Zucker Abrams Zucker movie where not every joke hits, but there's so many of them, so frequent that
trust me, one out of ten. I'm used to jokes not hitting. Don't
yeah. So, ain't that the truth? No.
You didn't even see rehearsals. It was rough out there.
So it was, I feel really proud of it. And, the way to make that work, the way to save it, I didn't have to. I willingly and lovingly acquired it, acquired the brand. And so when I did that, I wasn't thinking that the only goal is just to make sure that everyone can play Duke Nukem Forever. The real goal for me is I'd like to build a Duke Nukem game again.
Yeah.
And I'd like to, because I think what I would do and I think what Gearbox would do would be a little different. And I think it would be amazing. And I look forward to that.
Okay, great. Now, jumping off that for a little bit, what is it like to be Randy Pitchford now? You talk about how you started on this Duke Nukem game way back in the day, and now you were able to, your Gearbox is this super megalith. It's successful. Everybody loves it. You got Borderlands. Everybody loves it. You were able to come in and pick up this game that gave you your start and try to help out. It's been crazy, because I remember when Borderlands first got announced, the number one Borderlands there, it was like, oh, this is an interesting, weird, mainstreamed RPG.
A lot of people didn't think it was going
to
work.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And now look at you. You're just laughing all the way to the blue bank.
I'm not laughing. Well, we obviously love, the intent behind Borderlands. That's obviously we believed in it. We wouldn't have committed in it otherwise. And the fact that other people found it and found joy in it, it's like, that's why we fight. That's the dream, So we're living the dream. But, honestly, you asked me what it's like. I feel like I feel like I suck and I don't know shit and we're just figuring, I feel like we're just figuring things out. I feel like we're just getting started. Like I've been playing a lot of Borderlands 2, for example, and I went back and played some Borderlands 1, and Borderlands 1 feels like the friggin' Stone Age compared to where, it's crazy, how much quality and, everything we've learned, all the institutional knowledge and building on our systems and iterating and perfecting. It's kind of like, I have an iPhone, and I had the first generation iPhone, and I've got an iPhone 4 now. And if you go back to the old one, even though it's the same form factor and it's the same kind of thing, it feels like slow and old. And but it was awesome when it happened, So I feel like what's the next thing is really exciting and interesting to me. And I feel like that's what we need to keep our eye on. And there's just so much to do in this industry that we haven't even come close to exploring yet. That that's what keeps me up at night, is just dreaming about the future.
So how do you push those boundaries? How do you get to exploring
one step at a time? You know, yeah. You just keep going at it. You know, fortunately, I love what we do, and I work with people who are happiest in the world, just making stuff and solving interesting problems, and you know, committing to worthy challenges, and just trying to create and make stuff that pleases people. I know it's true for myself, and I think I speak on behalf of a lot of the studio. We're kind of like genetically built to create joy and happiness for other people, and you know, we're getting better and better at that as the more we do it. So it's really fun.
All right. So right now, my mom's watching this in Chicago, Illinois. Jamie Kennedy, she doesn't know what Borderlands is.
Okay.
So explain to somebody right now who's hearing about Borderlands for the first time. What is it? Why is Borderlands 2 going to be so great?
Borderlands is a game where a crazy psycho midget will run at you and you could punch his leg off.
Perfect. Pre-order now, Mom.
And take his stuff. Yeah. And take his stuff and then use it to punch the next
Gotcha, midget. Gotcha.
Yeah, it's wild. It's like, and the midget's on fire.
Okay. So, why did this find an audience? You talked about it, you know, a lot of people didn't think Borderlands 1 was going to work because it was this crazy, it's a first-person shooter RPG with 13,000 weapons that can be
13,000.
Completely changed.
Oh, so humble. You know, the Guinness Book of World Records recently awarded the first Borderlands with the world record for most guns in a video game. And they counted 17,750,000-something.
I was a bit off.
And when they presented me with the certificate, it was actually in June.
Yeah.
We knew it was going to happen, but I didn't. Like, I was actually on a TV show, and they invited the Guinness people to come on, and I didn't expect that.
Yeah.
And so I was like, oh, this is really awesome. I was really surprised. And then I said, but this is cool and all, but like, we already broke this record, so you're going to have to start, like, in a few months, you're going to have to start counting all over again.
Funny you mentioned that. No, they're not here.
That would have been something.
That would have been awesome, right? Break the door.
I was like, what? For a moment, you had me. Just a moment.
Yeah, just a moment.
But
like most of the audience.
Why did it work? For me, shooters are fun. It's fun. Just there's this, like, we have this kind of like reptilian brain. Some people call it the reptilian brain, which kind of handles our primal motivations, like, you know, where we think like, oh, I need to eat that, or that's going to kill me, avoid that, okay, or like have sex with that, or, you know, whatever.
That's my favorite
one.
No,
it's like really like the most primal kind of instincts, right? And we have this like we've evolved into this kind of having these intellectual capacities, you know, that have higher motivations, you know. There's, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of motivations and stuff. The shooter always kind of spoke to that primal kind of thing. It just feels good to kind of like move and aim and to jump and just shoot, and you get this feedback and like, you know, it's just, and you can't even explain it, but like just in this, the moment to moment play, it's just fun. It just, there's just something that's rewarding and feeling good about a shooter that's done really well. But you know, the thing about shooters is they're just kind of like, you know, you just throw different stuff at us, and you know, the character at the end of pretty much every shooter you've ever played is identical to the character at the beginning in terms of what he can do, how high he can jump, for example, or what you know. Yeah, you find some new guns along the way, but it's not like they get better. You know, it's like maybe you get like a new little gadget that does something, but for the most part, the characters stay the same. And then meanwhile, there's this whole other genre, the role-playing game genre, where there's nothing moment to moment about it. Like back in the early days of Hack, it was like turn-based, and all like text characters were representing the things. Like the predecessor to Diablo was like, it was called Hack, right? And the fun had nothing to do with that visceral kind of, you know, the reptilian brain motives. The fun of these games is about you know, making decisions, having choices about
changing,
like,
your character.
This character or that character. And then once you made a choice, how do I configure that character? And then what gear do I pick? Oh, here's a tool that this one does more damage, but that one's more accurate and is faster. Ah, that's an interesting choice.
What do I do?
Right? And then making that choice and then feeling the effects of that choice, and it's like really gratifying, and then over time growing and becoming more and more powerful, more and more capable, so that at the end you're just this radically, you're like godlike in power compared to where you were at the beginning. And that's a whole different set of motivations and engagement that's kind of long range. And what occurred to us was that the fun that happens from those games is actually not mutually exclusive to the fun that happens in this kind of visceral moment-to-moment shooter. Mm-hmm. And we realize, holy crap, that is chocolate, and that's freaking peanut butter. And if we just put these things together, we can have, this could be amazing, you know? So we did, and holy crap, peanut butter cups taste pretty good.
Yeah. So then how do you improve Peanut Butter Cups for Borderlands 2? Is it as simple as making more guns, or is it something with story, or what are
so,
you doing?
So, you know, in the case of Borderlands, to, you know, I don't want it, the metaphor to break down, so let's come out of the analogy and into the real thing. So part of it's about iteration, right? The for the core systems, for the loop of what works, you know, the loop, both the shooter loop and the RPG loop, it's about iterating and perfecting those systems. It's kind of like that analogy I mentioned a little while ago about the iPhone, right? Like, if you think about it, like on the surface, the original iPhone and the second generation iPhone are almost identical in form factor and function. But in terms of how they work, what they do, how fast they are, the user interfaces, the features that are there, like the new one is like a perfected, kind of polished, iterated version of that original invention. And so iterating and perfecting the invention of this combination, this peanut butter cup was a big part of it. But experientially, from like the places you explore and the adventure you're going to go on, the challenges you'll face, the villain that thwarts you, all of the experiential stuff, the loot you gather and the enemies you'll deal with, all of that stuff, we wanted it to be all new. So that Borderlands 2 it's a completely new experience. Every single bit has been built for Borderlands 2 from scratch, and I'm so proud of the team, and man, it's just an astonishing. I mean, I obviously I'm a part of it, so I'm not totally objective, but I mean,
you're not going to review it for IGN.
No, that's a good but it's the best thing we've ever done. Like, wow. And it's not even close. It's not even close.
Is Claptrap back?
We almost fired him.
Oh, you can't fire Claptrap.
I know. Well, that's what he said. And he's a little, he's a little pushy sometimes, but he's kind of a jerk. But you know, he's charming in his own way. So, yeah, he's around.
Okay.
He's around.
Good,
but
good.
He's on his last leg though. We got our eyes on
him. You're watching him.
All right. One more misstep and he's out of there.
Of course, game out next week.
Yes.
Review live on IGN, 13th, September 13th. Come to IGN.com, please.
And the game launches on the 18th.
Yeah, that's okay. But 13th is when you can come review. Right now, though, if people were wanting to get back in and get their feet wet, over on PlayStation Plus, I think this is a brilliant move. You guys put Borderlands up as one of the free games for PlayStation Plus.
Yeah.
How does that work? Did you go to Sony? Did they come to you?
What happened was 2K came to us and said, hey, this could happen. I don't know if the idea started at 2K or Sony. I think it actually started at Sony, but I'm not sure. And they said, how would you feel about this? And I thought, you know, it's if you ever want something from me, just tell me that, like, you want, because I have a weakness, which is when we create stuff, we just want everyone to enjoy it.
Sure.
So the idea that people are going to get that for free, like, that means more people are gonna play it. Sweet, you know. It's like, we said, yeah, absolutely, it's a good idea. Now we're smart. We're not gonna make irresponsible decisions, and you know, we know there's a business to it. And if I make the kind of decisions that lead to us like not at least making what we spent, then we have to stop, and that's the worst thing in the world when you
sure.
think about, like, I'm only dreaming about what we can build upon, right, and what we can do next. So we make responsible decisions, but in this case. You know, we're talking about PlayStation Plus customers. They're committed gamers. If there's anyone that loves a game like Borderlands when they discover it, it's a committed gamer, right?
Yeah.
And they just
yeah.
need to try it and they see how wonderful it is. And you know, I know a lot of the people that are going to get it, they probably already bought the game, but it's neat to have the digital
sure.
convenient
yeah, yeah.
download, so it's always on the hard drive and they don't have to worry about finding the disc anymore. And that's kind of nice to let people do that. And it just seemed like the right thing to do and a good and I gotta tell you, the PlayStation 3 version of Borderlands 2 is amazing. Like, if you played Borderlands 1 on PlayStation 3,
yeah,
it's leaps and bounds. If you're a PlayStation 3 guy, you're gonna, like, it's not, like, I mean, the Xbox version is great and the PC version is awesome, but relatively speaking, like, first of all of the networking and all of that stuff is totally native PSN, so it feels like a first party game. Right. Well, compared to, like, in Borderlands 1, we licensed GameSpy and we had, there's a lot of kind of hodgepodgey, like, oh God, we got to make this work kind of stuff.
Band-aids and duct tape.
Yeah, yeah. But, like, this is, like, pure, and Chase and his team just dove right in there and they owned it. And we got a lot of, we got a large contingent of PS3 fanboys within the studio that really wanted to make that experience nice and really high quality. And I'm really proud of it. And I think if you're and what's another thing that's neat about it, too, is, there's a lot of PlayStation customers that are kind of on the out. Like, there's a lot of core gamers on the PlayStation, but there's also a lot of more casual gamers.
Yeah.
And, like, if you want a shared experience, like a co-op game or a game that you can play split screen, or a game that you can, you know, play with somebody who's somewhere else in the world, you know, but you got a friend that moved to a different town or whatever, like Borderlands is one of the best games, period, like on the planet to have that experience. And I think the PlayStation makes it really convenient and really nice. So I'm really eager and excited for PlayStation customers to see what we've done there.
Mm-hmm. Now you're talking about PlayStation customers. If we continue down that line of thinking, you made some headlines a while back. Borderlands and Vita started getting talked about together. Mm-hmm. What are you doing there? Is this happening? Because I would really like something to play on my
happened,
Vita.
What happened there, me too, I love my Vita. What I think is a really neat piece of hardware. We need games, and they know it. They've told us. Sony, you know, Shu told us that you know he knows that we need to have more games on the platform. But I was at an event in London, in UK. It was in Brighton, actually, on the beach, and we demonstrated Borderlands 2, and then I took some questions from the audience, and somebody said, "Hey, you know, what do you think about the Vita, and can we have Borderlands 2 on the Vita?" And I said, "I think that would be awesome. I think it would be awesome to have Borderlands 2 on the Vita." I said, "I'm really busy, so like we can't do it ourselves. But if some other studio was capable and could be trusted by us and by a publishing partner and by Sony,
sure,
and someone wanted to invest in making that happen, like I think Sony should step up and make that happen. I don't think it would cost a lot, relatively speaking.
Yeah.
I mean, you know."
What's
a lot to development process, you know, or what's not a lot to development might be a lot to an individual. But I think as projects go, that could be an efficient kind of effort. And I think Sony should step up there. And I know there's a lot of talented people that have learned how to use the Vita that could do a great job at that. And I just wanted to say that if that machine started to align itself, I wouldn't be the holdup. I would actually be an enabler.
Gotcha.
But we don't have any effort. We don't have time. We can't afford it.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think it would be great, and I'd love to play. And what I'd love to do, like the dream scenario for me, would be, you know, I'm playing the game on my PS3. Imagine you could be playing the game on your PS3, and then like, okay, I have to go on a road trip, or I have to go to work or something. And when I take my Vita with me, I have access to the same cloud save, and I can continue my character. Can you imagine how amazing that would be?
I'm very much for this.
Can you imagine a world where like at E3 during their press conference, like Sony announced that was happening with Borderlands 2, and that we'd all be like, oh yeah,
yeah,
that is what the Vita is all about, right? That's like the promise realized. And so I hope Sony decides, like, you know what, we should make this happen.
So there's been no one's come to you yet. Jeff Rubenstein hasn't come knocking on your door.
Christoph and I have talked about it. He and I are, Christoph's the head of 2K Games, and he's really busy, and you know he likes the platform. He really wishes to get more love from Sony, like for some reason, and maybe because, you know, we're a newer brand. I don't know. Borderlands is a newer brand, but like I think between us, we really wish that Sony would get behind us more, especially since we're getting behind Sony. And I think the Sony customers would love our game, and the ones that have already found it love it. And I think more would love it. And I think there's a lot to say for all of their platforms, for the Vita,
sure,
for mobile, and for the console. And but I love the Sony guys. In fact, I'm going to be meeting with them again soon, and we talk periodically, and maybe it'll come up.
Okay, yeah, make sure it comes up. I'm sure everybody out there wants this to happen. Right now, go ahead, Craig, put it up. Tweet at YoSP, that's Shuhei Yoshida. He's president of Sony Worldwide Studios. Tell him you'd like to see Borderlands 2 on the Vita, and he needs to talk to Randy over here and make it happen. And we'll have it.
She's a good guy.
She's a great guy. Yeah, yeah. Beating my butt at the treasure game on the Vita. Oh, yeah. He keeps sending me maps and just smoking me left and right.
We're fortunate to have a guy like Shu in the CDs in, because he plays the games and he cares.
Yeah, yeah. Talking about other games, a lot going on at Gearbox still.
Yes.
Borderlands 2 isn't it for you guys. You got this Aliens game coming up.
Yes. Yeah,
When's this one coming up?
Aliens comes in February.
Oh my gosh.
And
so
I know. It's well, you know, time is relative, right? To us in development, you know, it feels like it's really close. I think to a gamer, you know, there's that gamer that's in January, he's like bored of all the,
sure,
the quick burn games he got over Christmas or whatever. You just burn through the campaign and you're done. Aliens comes in February, and we're really excited about it. I mean, it's like, I just can't get over the fact that Fox has trusted us to make an original canonical sequel to the movies as a video game. Like,
was that a hard sell? Like, that's what I'm talking about. You're like, well, you know, I started on Duke Nukem, and now you're like, well, I'm gonna log in. I'm gonna just tell Sony how to run their platforms, and I'm gonna make this Aliens game.
I'm not trying to tell anybody anything. I think Sony does an amazing job, especially when you think about the complexity of their business. I'm not sure I'm in a position to tell them what to do, but I can certainly share what my interests are.
I do it all the time. You just say it.
With respect to the Fox thing, and you know, we Brian, well, you know, the story goes back after we launched the first Brothers in Arms game in 2005. You know, we kind of came to the table and we thought, wow, okay, that was amazing. You know, we just got, you know, 90 plus scores and sold 3.5 million units of Brothers in Arms Road to Hill 30. So obviously we should do more of that. And we loved it and we weren't done. And we're still not done, by the way. If anybody is a Brothers in Arms fan, we have more to do there. But we said, okay, so let's do more of that. Also, because that was successful, we're in a unique position where we can get one of our other ideas that no one else is doing anything like it that we want to get off the table. So let's start talking with publishing partners and let's get another IP built. That became Borderlands.
Ah, okay.
And the third thread was, you know, it's been since we launched Halo for PC that we had fun playing in the space of other people's properties. And part of why we created the studio is because there's so much awesome stuff in the world that other people have made that we'd love to play in that space with interactive entertainment. Sometimes it's games like when Valve and Sierra trusted us to do all of the expansions and all of the console versions of Half-Life. Mm-hmm. Like, what a great space to work in, so much fun, and we got so much joy and, you know, created so much, you know, I think joy for others with our work there. We really get off on playing with other people's stuff. So we made a list of all of our favorite properties and like dream projects basically. And the top of that list was Aliens.
Wow.
And so Brian Martell's one of my partners, one of the owners of Gearbox. He started attacking that from the talent point of view. And he had a meeting with Ridley Scott to talk about the franchise. And I'll never ever forgive him for not making sure I was there at that meeting. Like, he came back, he's like, Randy, it was amazing. So Ridley, he pulls out, he digs out his this book and he blows the dust off of it. And it's clear no one's looked at this thing for like 20 years. And he opens it up and it's the original storyboards from Alien. And Ridley himself hand drew all of the storyboards,
wow.
Right? And I'm gonna have to go to the bathroom and relieve myself, but because like it's the awesome. But why did you have me there? Like, you know, it's so, you know, because, you know, who doesn't nerd out over Aliens?
Sure.
It's like the greatest science fiction franchise ever, right? And so authentic and so rad. So that meeting kind of started the spark. And I wasn't at the meeting, but this was in end of 2005 or early 2006, and they talked about like the space jockey. And they talked about the derelict. And I have a very strong hunch, given that that was the dust on the storyboards and all that, I have a very strong hunch that discussion not only sparked the creative kind of seed that led to us doing Aliens Colonial Marines, yeah. But I have a very strong hunch that it also kind of sparked Ridley, and that led to the Prometheus film that we got. And so these different, you know, that meeting of really talented, creative people kind of led to these things being created.
You're just out there changing people's lives.
Well, you know, we're still working hard. We need to deliver on it. But man, the fantasy, like I've wanted to, you know, fulfill that fantasy of like being a Colonial Marine.
Yeah, yeah.
Like for real.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think some of the AVP games are great, but you know, to be fair, I want the authentic, you know, and there were no Predators in Ridley Scott's universe. There are no Predators in James Cameron's universe. And I think it's an awesome what if, but there's never ever been an original story in the Aliens in fiction that's been a video game. The video games have either been the what if, you know, what if there were Predators kind of games, or they've been just sort of rehashes of a film that existed. And to me, there's this really unscratched itch, right? Like Alien 3, kind of, it was neat to spend a little more time with Ripley, and it was kind of, it was David Fincher's first film, and it was kind of cool to go back to the tension kind of thing, but it didn't really deal with the, we've got a big problem on our hands now, and suddenly they're, you know, now we know the universe is much larger, and we're thinking about how Marines play into it, and the military component, and what if one of those things gets to Earth, and there's all these, like, untied things, and these characters that we loved, and then, you know, the fourth, the Resurrected, is like totally different.
Way
in the future. And I love Joss and all. It was great, but it was like not following that thread, right?
Sure.
So like to be able to go in there and to put the thing in that takes place after Aliens and to do it right, it's just like this. And we haven't spoiled shit. We've been very careful, but it's, I can't believe what we've been able to do. Like it's something.
All right.
If you're
one
an
final
alien
question,
fan, it's something.
And not about Aliens. You mentioned Brothers in Arms.
Yeah.
At PAX, you talked about Brothers in Arms, Furious 4 is no longer a Brothers in Arms game. What's happening with that?
Well, when we began that effort.
Table got closer. I didn't know something.
When we began that effort, you know, we really kind of, we wanted from a design point to kind of let that be a little unshackled. And it started iterating on some gameplay mechanisms and some gameplay experiences that were really fun. And it really needed to just unshackle completely. Because Brothers in Arms is really supposed to be an authentic, you know, really the hallmarks of the Brothers in Arms series are about authenticity, you know, squad combat, brotherhood between soldiers.
Sure.
I mean, it is, like, we really commit to the, and have a tremendous amount of deference to the subject matter with the Brothers in Arms games. Mm-hmm. So that we should honor that commitment, and all Brothers in Arms games should do that.
Gotcha.
And what was happening with Furious 4 is it wanted the game loop, and I, as a designer, like, I don't want to shackle that. I actually want to unhinge that and let it go. And so by just removing the Brothers in Arms part and letting that become its own new IP, it can get really unshackled, and it's going in a very exciting place. And I know that some people are like, what happened? Well, you know, creativity is a process and invention's a process, but when we do reannounce that game, it will appear as a new IP. And I think what people see in it, like, you think it's cool how we blended RPGs and shooters together? Mm-hmm. Like, we're onto something that is extremely exciting. Like, okay. I can't wait until it's time. It's still evolving though, so it would be reckless.
Yeah, you don't want to.
If I announced it now, it will continue to evolve, and then we'll be in that same spot again. We're like, oh, you remember that thing? It's actually changed even more again. And we need to let it get to its full ripeness before we take a bite of that fruit. And
are you still working with Ubisoft on it, or is it?
You know, Ubisoft's a great partner. When we reannounce the game, we'll announce the title, the new promise of the game, and the publishing arrangement, and all of that, and give people some guidance about its window, and its timing, and all
you
of that.
You let the cake keep baking. Don't worry.
Yeah, it's yeah. But you know, and then likewise, you know, I've also not been shy to say that, you know, for what Brothers in Arms is meant to be, we love that too, and we do have some creative effort going on there that will lead eventually to a project that we'll announce at some point. But it's also too early to announce that one.
Okay.
But we love that, and we've got some action there as well.
Well, great.
Yeah.
Borderlands 2 is the cake that's done.
Dude.
September 18th.
It is, yeah, and you know,
September 13th on IGN.com, read about
that. you know what's neat about Borderlands 2 being, you know, imminent, because we went into certification, gosh, about 6 weeks ago,
uh-huh.
And there's, you know, because it takes time to take, you have the game finished, it takes time to, like, prove that it's finished, finalize it, get it all prepared, and then once you have that master disc, you got to manufacture it and then distribute it, and there's also some effort to prop it digitally for digital customers, and there's this gap there. So the minute we were done, we got to work on, like, we there was so much momentum on the team, we didn't want to stop. So, you know, I'd already
three done.
no, we'd already announced that we added the ability to add new characters to the game as DLC, and we announced that the first one was going to be the Necromancer character, and we promised that if anyone already knows they're going to be a Borderlands 2 customer and they pre-order it, they'll get the Necromancer character for free. That's going to be, we did announce that will be launched in mid-October. So it'll be about a month after the game comes out that the Necromancer will be available. It's still going to be free if you've pre-ordered it when it comes out. If you haven't pre-ordered it, it's going to be $10.
Okay.
But what's neat about it, what's different than when we first announced that and now, is we got to work on it and build it, and it's freaking awesome. It's freaking awesome. I'm so excited about this. And I love all the characters. In fact, you can go on IGN website.
Yeah,
I just spent some time walking through some details of the skill trees and some different build combinations that are cool. And so there's, like, different snippets for each of the four characters. Maybe I'll come back again and do it for the Necromancer soon. But man, she is just such a badass character and so awesome. And if you already know you want the game, just get it, because pre-order it, because then you don't have to pay and it's free if you do that. So get in there now. Mm. There's only around the corner, it won't be possible to pre-order it,
and so you'll
miss out on the free thing.
Right.
And the fact that our publisher is offering that for free is just rad of them, you know. Because again, to me, I just want everybody to play our stuff.
Yeah.
So,
well, I'm sure they will.
Awesome.
Randy, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Cheers.
Don't go anywhere. Okay.